Good evening, everyone. As Payal said, thank you for being here. And of course, there are five other women who joined the two of us in welcoming you here today. There's Nina, there's Ritu, who all of you know. There's Shuli, Rimjim, and Anjali, a couple of whom aren't here physically, but this is the team of women who put it together. So thank you. You know, in many ways, about 2 years ago, we had invited Dr. Swamy to Algebra. And that day we declared that we are going to start a series of Swamy conversations because it's not enough to have just one of them. We'd urge you to go to the Algebra website, which is www.algebratheclub.com, and look up the first season of Dr. Swamy, because this is the second season of Dr. Swamy, and we're delighted to bring him here in Chennai. You know, it's very easy to run through the bio data, but it would be mundane to run through the bio data of Dr. Subramanian Swamy. There are some highlights, you know, that he's amongst the youngest to ever get a PhD from Harvard. He was 24. You know, he worked with Samuelson, who only collaborated ever, you know, a Nobel Prize winner in economics, only collaborated ever with about five people. Dr. Swamy was one of them. And he has many other feathers in his cap. But he came back to India to teach at the IIT and in other universities. And he was out of sync with the times because he believed in a market economy at a time when we were a mixed and socialist economy. And he was really booted out of the firmament by those who held power at that time, which included Mrs. Indira Gandhi and Amartya Sen. So Dr. Swamy picked fights at that time because others picked fights with him. And he is famously now known, he says it is first Mrs. Sonia Gandhi who identified this trait in him as having a Sicilian streak for revenge. But it's not just an Indian level of revenge, it's a Sicilian streak for revenge. And he has really sustained that with different people across time. We've mentioned some of that before. There's been Chidambaram, Jayalalitha, Mrs. Gandhi, Amartya Sen, Mr. Chidambaram, you name it, I included, though we are friends now. But that is really not what makes Dr. Swamy someone so anticipated. He speaks of himself as someone whose job is to shock and awe. We know of him in public discourse as being somebody who's always escalating the level of discourse till it requires a response. And he looks at himself as a catalyst, as a catalytic member of public discourse. Today, we would love to examine many of his positions on the economy, on Ayodhya, on politics, on Sabarimala, on the RBI governors, on a whole host of issues, because he is in the midst of every public conversation that dominates India. I can only assure you that it'll be a lively conversation, a civil one, and a combative one. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Dr. Swamy. Thank you very much for the second edition of Dr. Swamy. I wanted to start on a...
It won't be a revised edition.
Not a revised edition, no. I thought we should start on a soft note between you and me because we are accustomed to combat. So in 2014, when the NDA and BJP was really fighting to come into power, you said that if the NDA and Mr. Modi was elected, the rupee which was running at rupees 61 would appreciate to rupees 35. Today, when it is exactly double of that, do you think we should be grateful that you're not the finance minister of this country?
Well, I made that prediction on the assumption, which was based on what I was told, that I would be finance minister. And you make me finance minister again, I'll bring it down to 35.
You have influence on the oil economy of the world?
No, it's not that. It's simple economics. Most people don't know economics. Economics is a macroeconomic system where what you do here has an effect somewhere else. And most of the other people think economics is common sense, but that's mostly bilateral transactions they think of. And there you see, that's what we call in economics as microeconomics. And there you see, if demand rises, prices will rise. And if demand falls, prices will fall. But in macroeconomics, if demand rises, prices can fall also. So it depends. So that sophistication you can get only if you have been professionally trained in economics.
Would you say that our current finance minister has been professionally trained in economics? Does he pass muster?
I don't think he's professionally trained in anything.
And this is someone who doesn't, we'll get to the Sicilian bits. He's still at an Indian level of conversation. But Dr. Swamy, let's, you know, you are famous for, as I said, being a catalyst in public discourse, and we'll come back a little bit to the economy. But I wanted to ask you that when Mr. Raghuram Rajan left the country as RBI director, you were one of those who actually pushed to have him resign.
Yes.
You said that he's only mentally half Indian,
yes,
which made him sound mentally unsound, you know. But the question I'd like to put to you is that when you said he's only mentally half Indian, he's actually someone who shared your broad vision of economics, you know, came, which was really to believe in a market economy, in capitalism. Today, would you accept that when Mr. S. Gurumurthy is made the director of the RBI, he believes in Swadeshi economics? Do you think it's a good choice?
I don't think the Gurumurthy has been made a director. It's in
he's on the board of he's on the
it's
board
in
of
some part of it. He's essentially a chartered accountant, and I wouldn't classify him as an economist. Economist is someone who understands macroeconomics. Not bilateral transactions in economics, I mean in financial matters. The problem with Raghuram Rajan was also that he got a degree from IIT Delhi, and then he went to Ahmedabad, and then he went to MIT. And he dealt only with finance. Finance is a single dimensional subject. And therefore, unless you are professionally trained in economics, you will not understand the macroeconomics.
So the question I was putting to you is that, you know, when you're saying that Mr. Gurumurthy is not an economist,
yes.
Do you approve because you have a say in who gets to be in the
no,
RBI
no,
or
no,
not?
No, no, no.
Do you approve of his
appointment? I have a say on who can remain there, but not on who can be taken.
Well, we'll move away momentarily from personalities. You know, it's very interesting that in the edition one of Dr. Swamy at Algebra, you had said that you advised Mr. Modi that good governance is not enough to win elections.
Absolutely.
And you suggested that he up the emotive quotient.
That's right.
And you mentioned several prime ministers, including Mr. Narasimha Rao and Mr. Vajpayee, Morarji Desai.
Right.
From, you know, under Mr. Narasimha Rao, the Hindu rate of growth jumped from 3 to 9%.
That's right.
But you said it's not enough.
That's right. He lost
so
the elections.
So I would again put to you that Mr. Modi came on a real hope vote, promising good governance, good economics, jobs for all.
Yes.
You don't think that that's good politics?
That's not enough to win an election. And that's my experience of the last so many years. Indian people react much better when there's an emotional factor. And I'm telling you, the economy is in a miserable state. I have no hesitation in saying that. But still, I'll say 2019 will get majority, because the Hindutva platform of ours has now spread very far and wide in the minds of the young generation who come out in larger numbers to vote. And on power and corruption, although we haven't done all that we promised, but there's first no major allegation or substantive allegation of corruption against the present government. And second, there are things that I have done, and I'm very close to sending many of them to jail, so much so that Modi himself said that Congress is a bail gaddy, because they're all out
on
bail.
And you're the bullet train?
Well, I'm trying to make it fast, but the finance ministry is putting lots of blocks, but I'll overcome that.
Okay. You know, you mentioned about Hindutva having spread into society, and I'm going to come back to that. Because it's a very, very important issue, and with you know, with the recent RSS glasnost, as it's been called, we will come to that conversation. But before that, I just wanted, you know, about speaking about Mr. S. Gurumurthy.
Yes.
The Sabarimala judgment just came out.
Yes.
and you have been pro the Supreme Court making this a gender justice 100%. Issue. But S. Gurumurthy had tweeted that perhaps the Kerala floods happened because Ayyappan was angry. do you feel comfortable keeping company with people who believe these things? And has the economy tanked because the Ram Mandir has not been built?
I'll ask Gurumurthy which iPhone he is using, that he could find out what Ayyappa had thought. I don't believe that you can have, according to Hindu religion, you can have a conversation with God, but then the amount of training and sacrifice you have to make for it, most of us don't. And we don't have that kind of concentration. I don't never buy any such thing that gods are angry or so on, because I don't think that normal human beings know really what God is thinking. You just accept whatever happens as God's doing, but nothing more.
So, let's shift then to, as you said, the idea of Hindutva.
Yes.
Before that, just because it's something that, you know, many people would be discussing and thinking about, that while the Supreme Court has adjudicated on the Sabarimala issue, there are massive protests in Kerala, including by women who feel that their faith has been interjected on unduly.
Yeah.
Where would you stand on the issue of the Supreme Court interjecting on faith? And Mr. Jaitley feels that this is something that the Supreme Court should not have interjected on.
You put the red rag in front of the bull again.
I'm playing you, Dr. Swamy.
Well, first of all, let me tell you that Article 25, which gives you fundamental right to your pursuit of religion, is prefaced by saying subject to the question of morality, public order, and health. Everyone has a fundamental right to profess his religion. Now, this is also subject, this fundamental right of 25 is also subject to other fundamental rights in the Constitution. Article 14 says that all are equal before the law. So men and women are equal before the law. And as far as the question of banning menstruating women, I do not know under what religious sanction this is done. Remember that Hinduism has two branches of religion. One we call a Shruti, Vedas, Upanishads, Brahmanas, Aranyakas. These are God-communicated knowledge, and they cannot be amended. And then we call something called Smriti, which is like the Shastras. Manu Shastra, after that came Yajnavalkya Shastra, after that came Mitaksha Shastra. Those are amendable. And this concept of a woman who's menstruating cannot go to Ayyappa temple is part of the Shastras. And now we have a constitution, and the constitution says you cannot discriminate between man and woman. If the women who are protesting, I'll say there's nothing to stop you from not going. It is you want to prevent those who want to go. That is an intrusion of their fundamental right. This is a highly misplaced agitation.
That's well said, sir, that those who don't want to go in need not go in, but should not prohibit the rights of others.
Yes.
It's very interesting you said that Article 25 is prefaced by the idea of morality, public order, and you know certain caveats, constitutional morality.
Yes.
But you are a staunch advocate of building the Ayodhya temple.
Yeah.
And you say it's my way or the highway now.
Yes.
This temple was, the mosque there was brought down by a criminal act.
Yes.
Would you say that now public constitutional morality has kicked in? And in your case, are you now willing to violate and flout that to assert your right of faith?
No. See, you're mixing up two things. You're a typical liberal. You're always confused about...
So you'll notice that we've put no name tags on you yet.
I'll tell you this.
It's poor combat to start naming people.
Whoever was responsible for breaking the masjid, Babri Masjid, they have been identified, rightly or wrongly, by the police authorities and a commissioner inquiry, Liberan's commission inquiry, and there is a prosecution going on. During the period of the NDA, this prosecution declared them innocent because they didn't have any proof. During the 10 years of the UPA, they never appealed against that order. And then Narendra Modi, his government appealed against that order and reinstated that case. And that case today is going on, where Advani and Uma Bharti and...
Did Mr. Modi reinstate that case because he also has a Sicilian streak of revenge?
Well, I don't know, but the fact is that the Advani, Uma Bharti and Mamuli Manoj Joshi, rightly or wrongly, were accused in the earlier one. So he just revived that case. Now, so as far as those who broke or allegedly broke the Babri Masjid, they are being prosecuted. Now question comes, what is my right over the Muslim for building a Ram temple? So there, I've just won a recent victory, which I'll tell you why it's so important and why I'm now sure that you either have to go to the highway or you have to come my way. And that is this, that under Article 25, I have a fundamental right to pray at a spot which I considered as sacred. And the criminal law says sacred is what a large number of people believe it to be true. And that's the world over. Christ was born in Bethlehem. How do we know that? You go back and you find that the emperor, the king Constantine of Italy, his mother had a dream that Christ was born in a particular place in Bethlehem, and the Christian community has accepted that. Al-Aqsa is claimed by the Muslims, even though it is built on a Solomon, in a Jewish temple. On what grounds? That some mullahs dreamt that Muhammad went on a horse up to heaven from Al-Aqsa. So Al-Aqsa has become sacred for them. Now, as far as Babri Masjid is concerned, it was built on the basis of demolishing a temple and a superstructure put on it. At the very least, it has been established by the Archaeological Survey of India on a direction of the Supreme Court that there exists even today a large Vaishnav temple in ruins, and the masjid is built on it. So, now, just to make it as brief as possible, Narasimha Rao's government was asked by the Supreme Court in 1994, what is your solution to this problem? And he's given a written affidavit that if it is ever established by scientific means that there was a pre-existing temple, we'll hand over the land to the Hindus. Okay, so now, I am saying I have a fundamental right to pray there. Muslims have not claimed any fundamental right to pray in a masjid. They cannot. The Islamic practice is that it's a congregation hall and nothing more. And namaz can be read in the streets. It can be read here, right here, in your drawing room, etc. So now there's a clash between my fundamental right and the ordinary right to property claimed by the Sunni Waqf Board, that Babur conquered this land, and therefore Muslims are the owners of it. And therefore my fundamental right will prevail, and that's why I'm confident now today, because some clever lawyers tried to strike down that order of the Supreme Court which said that mosques are not an essential part of Islamic religion. They can be demolished, and that failed. So now the door is open for me.
But Dr. Swamy, it's very interesting. You're right that the Supreme Court has ruled that masjids are not essential part of Muslim prayer. They can pray anywhere. But the original suit over the Ram Mandir was really a battle over property between three, Ramlala, you know, the Ramnyas movement and the Sunni Waqf Board. Yeah. It was a battle over property.
Yes.
You insinuated yourself into that with the right to faith.
Right.
It's very interesting because you are somebody who is publicly, including on the Algebra platform, said that you don't necessarily go to temples as an act of faith.
Yeah.
You know, so this really boils back to a desire for cultural dominance. You're not even a believer. You want to create this as an act of cultural dominance, sir. And I would again put to you, why is it so important for you? And if I may just take a moment to share with you and the audience. Just yesterday, I was in a UP town called Suar in Uttar Pradesh, where there are some carpenters with whom one is collaborating. One wanted them to do some work. And they said, please ensure that this work is done very quickly. You know, and I said, why? They said, because Ramlila is coming up. And in Suar, because it is a Muslim-dominated town with very few Hindus, they said, we Muslims get together and we put up a Ramlila ground.
Yes.
And for 20 days now, there's almost going to be no work because we celebrate Ramlila. I said, oh, really, what is the program? Is there song and dance? They said, no, it is the story of Ram and Sita. And the whole Muslim town goes there to participate in it, including with the Hindus. So when that stream runs through our country, by and large, why would you insist on an act of cultural dominance which will create friction in the society?
Because the Mandir was demolished. They could have built a masjid anywhere when Babur's commander, Mir Baki, came. But he chose it directly there. And that they have done with 40,000 temples in our country. Now, I am not saying all 40,000 should be restored, but three are specially dear to the Hindus, and they've been fighting for centuries for it. One is this Ram temple in Ayodhya. It's not just Ram temple, it is Ram Lala temple, that is where Ram was born. There's no other place in the country where anybody thinks that Ram was born. Second is the Krishna Mandir in Mathura. And the third is the Kashi Vishwanath in Varanasi. These three temples we will get back. And we would like the Muslims, like they are cooperating in that town you mentioned, of building a Ramlila infrastructure. I would like them to voluntarily give up these three and keep the remaining of the 40,000. But they're not. Now, you said you don't go to temples, and therefore, why are you pushing for temples? Well, my name is Swami. I have a freedom to make you go to a temple, but not me go to a temple.
I see this is the Sabarimala issue in reverse.
Yes, that's right.
You don't want to go to a temple, but you want to force us to go to a temple.
No, I'm not forcing you. I'm only saying all those
this is your
crores and crores of Hindus who want Ram temple, I'm building it for them. You need not come.
But sir, I'd like to put to you that this is less an act of faith, more an act of political dominance. And I'd like to put to you a former compatriot of yours, Yashwant Sinha, who also on an Algebra platform, I challenged him for becoming liberal now because he was very close to Mr. Advani and those who had gone on the Rath Yatra. And he said that, well, the Ayodhya issue is a souffle and a souffle doesn't rise twice. Would you agree with that?
Well, that applies to him more than to a temple.
No, it is about the public emotion around the temple. You said you speak for crores of Indians. Are you Arnab Goswami?
No. Arnab Goswami only speaks of speaking to crores. I actually move within them. And you can go to any town and ask them what they think of me. You'll have only good things, except in your cocktail parties, all other places. Okay. Now,
Dr. Swami, I haven't even defined your habitat. You've defined mine as a cocktail party. That's unfair.
No, I'll say this, you see, that it's wrong to say the Hindus don't feel strongly about these three places. And right now the focus is that. And it is to a tribute to the Hindus that we are fighting through courts. And we are going to win. Second, there was a great poet of the Muslims called Iqbal. And he said, Ram is not just the god of the Hindus, he's Imam-e-Hind. Okay, so when Chandrasekhar was prime minister, our general, I was the president of the Janata Party at that time. Our general secretary was Shahabuddin. Shahabuddin was also the Babri Masjid Action Committee chairman. So we were very good friends. And so Chandrasekhar said, why don't you decide amongst yourselves what we should do about this? Because that time Vishwanda Parishad had threatened to do a Kal Seva. So both of us met, and it's now part of the white paper, that Shahabuddin said, if it is ever shown scientifically that there was previously a temple and a masjid is built on it, it's against the Quran, and therefore I myself will go and demolish it. And unfortunately, Chandrasekhar government didn't last, and by the time Narasimha Rao came and took stock of the situation, this was demolished.
So, Dr. Swamy, again, I would put to you two things. You know, this is a bit of a repetition from our previous conversation, right. So we'll go through it fast.
Yeah.
But one is that if the Supreme Court rules against the raising of the temple, yeah, and perhaps dictates something else,
yeah,
will you, just 2 days ago, the VHP, yeah, and others passed a resolution,
yes,
in short, my way or the highway.
Yeah.
But if the Supreme Court rules that we should let status quo and there should not be a temple or a masjid, something else, will you, speaking for the VHP and crores of others, accept that ruling? Or will you take to the streets and create another 1992?
I only accept that whatever I do will be legal. I will not go outside the Constitution. The Constitution provides the possibility, as we know from Shah Banu's case, that if the Supreme Court decides something, then I can, by a parliamentary resolution, overturn that judgment. There are some ifs and buts in that, but so that option is open to me legally. And therefore, I will exercise that.
Through an act of parliament?
Yes.
Okay.
I'm not doing anything illegal. It's there in the Constitution.
Okay. That brings us to another very important issue,
yes,
sir, which is that, again, in our I'm referring to our previous conversation, but taking it further,
yeah,
which is that when the last time we spoke about why you believe in the Hindutva regime,
yeah, yeah,
and in the idea of Hindutva,
right,
or a majoritarian sort of approach,
right,
to politics,
right,
you had said that you do believe that there is a principle of unity that runs through our country.
That's right.
Hindus and Muslims by and large,
right,
live together in,
right,
in good harmony.
That's right.
The Constitution enshrines that idea,
that's
of,
right,
plurality.
That's right.
And so when I asked you, why then is it important for you, for Muslims, to accept that they were Hindus once? You
no,
said
that their ancestors were.
That their ancestors were Hindus. You very candidly said that this is in fact a way of consolidating the Hindu vote,
yes,
which is very fractured, and it's a way of consolidating the Hindu vote. So, sir, again, I would put to you that today, when by and large the country is, you know, lives in peace, bringing up the Ayodhya issue, using it as an act of dominance,
yeah,
may fracture society again. And you had said then that we have a full control on the emotional button of this country. We are playing with it, but in Germany it went too far, but we have complete control over what we are doing.
That's
and
right.
We can keep the volume button.
Right. Right.
So my question to you, sir, is over these last 2-3 years, there have been very many incidents of lynching. Has that your sanction? Have you managed to keep your hand on the emotional control?
Well, if I had my sanctions, I know one or two people who should be lynched. I have not lynched them. The issue
but
is
more
this.
Seriously, sir, would
more
you condone?
More seriously, I'll tell you. I don't know who are behind this lynching. Certainly, we are not. Have we prosecuted those people? Yes. What have we found? None of them is BJP, even though media says so. I remember the very first incident that took place when he came to power, that in a place called Bahadurgarh, the media unanimously reported that a Harijan family was burnt alive in their house. Matter then was forgotten by the media, and I followed it up because Mulayam Singh Yadav's people were in power. And the investigation showed that there was a dispute in a scheduled caste family, and one section burnt the other section to grab the property. Have you seen any media report it? You please show me which case somebody has been prosecuted and the courts have said this man is a BJP man.
But Dr. Swamy, again, you are somebody who really acts on facts and empirical evidence. Yes. Let's go to Rajasthan, you know, where that love, the idea of love jihad, this man has spoken on video, burning a man down, hacking him to death on video, getting his nephew to film that.
Yes, but
and he framed that act of murder in the discourse of love jihad, which is propagated by the BJP, VHP and the entire Sangh Parivar family.
No,
sir, I would put to you many others, you know, including the boy who was hung. And we can go down many other episodes. We won't have the time to look at it individually. I would say that it is set in the discourse of Muslim versus Hindu, which is aroused by the Hindutva Sangh Parivar Brigade. I'm asking you again, sir, when you say you have control on that emotional button,
of course,
are you feeling that all this that is happening is all right?
Have you heard of a girl's name, lady's name, young lady's name called Naina Sharma? No. She was killed, chopped into pieces and put into a tandoori oven by, she was a Congress leader, by her husband in league with this. You know that what happened to the Sikhs in 1984?
Sir, you're more intellectually sound than to do whataboutry, sir.
No. First things first. I have not held the Congress party personally responsible for the Sikh thing, but it was the Congress party which did it. I'm saying that today, if you find some BJP people, you have to show that there was an order passed by the BJP, RSS, Vishnu Parishad, that go and do this lynch mob thing. I don't agree that I know BJP, I'm inside out. I'll tell you, there's not a single case. In fact, I think we sometimes get so agitated by this that you'll get a bad name, that we go to the other extreme. And some lot of people of our party cadre feels that we are not strong enough.
So when you say you go to the other extreme, Jayant Sinha garlanded some lynchers who had come out on bail. So, is that going the other extreme?
No, but that is not. That doesn't mean he's celebrating. These people are let out on bail. He came. I don't think much of his father or him. I hope he's not there in the next government. But I don't think he had committed any crime, you see. I think what you're trying to do is not what you, there's an attempt to paint us as Nasits who will be soon sending all Muslims to gas chambers. It's not like that at all. And we don't have that tradition. You started with an interesting question about our history. This Dravidian movement, what is this Dravidian movement? The word Dravid was invented by Adi Shankara as a sandhi of two words, Thra and Vid. Thra means three, Vid means the coast. So where the three coasts meet was called Dravid, and it soon became Dravid. And this was first used by Shankaracharya when he went, Adi Shankaracharya, when he went to Bihar to challenge the most notable Buddhist authority to a discussion. This concept of Shastrat is only there in Hindu religion, it's not there anywhere. He had a debate, he said, if I lose the debate, I become a Buddhist. If you lose the debate, you become a Hindu. He won the debate and Mandana Mishra became that. Now, that word, the British painted it as racial. And they said that, you know, all the people living in South, they are of different race. First, they were ruling the whole world, country, and then the Aryans came from Khyber Pass, beat them and drove them to the south. And there was a party here called Dravida Munnetra Kargam, where he said Ravan is a Dravida king because he was in Lanka. And we will celebrate Ravan Leela. And ultimately, I told Karunanidhi, Ravan was born near Delhi. There's a place called Bisrak thing you can go there. Bisrak is Sector 16.
Sector 16.
In Noida. You see, and he went to Kailash, he prayed to Lord Shiva. Shiva gave him a boon. With that, he came and conquered Lanka. And Karunanidhi went on. Similarly, he used the same ideology when I was fighting in the Supreme Court to save Ram Setu. He said, what is this? Who is this Ram Setu? Rama? He came from North India to kill our Dravidian king. And how did he build the bridge? Ram, Swami says it's Ram Setu. What is the meaning? How can it be Ram Setu? Was he an engineering graduate and all that? Next day he fell ill. And he was, taken to Ramchandra Medical Hospital.
So you're coming perilously close to S. Gurumurthy when you're saying that he questioned the Ram Setu and next day he fell ill.
No, I'm not saying that. He had many diseases, so they were coming turn by turn.
But as someone who believes in scientific data, how did you identify that Ravan was born in Sector 16 near Noida? I'm very interested.
You go there, there's a village. They put a signboard there.
Signboard? You believe in scientific evidence?
No. You can go and see the volumes, you see. And he was a bhakta of Shiva. We know that.
No, that we know.
Rahul Gandhi is also a Shiva bhakta.
So we'll momentarily, you know, the problem with discussing with you, sir, is that each issue can be 3 hours long.
So I'm telling you, we will not tolerate any infringement of law, any law and order problem. And this is not the first time lynching has taken place. It's not. There's a spate of lots of crimes that are being committed. We feel ashamed of it. But we fight. I fight. This Nirbhaya case, I was the one who went to the Supreme Court. And I wanted that boy who did that horrible things and mutilating the lady after the rape, I wanted him to be given capital punishment. And you would be surprised.
Sir,
it was the ladies who opposed me there in the Supreme Court. They're all Naxalites, of course, but still I call them
so
ladies.
So we haven't even touched the urban Naxal issue. We'll come to that. Huh. We'll move away from this topic. I'd just like to put one question to you. In the Kathua rape case, where a little 8-year-old was brutalized, there were members of the BJP lawyers who came out in support of the alleged rapists. Would you at least take a very strong position against extend empathy?
They did not. Those people did not defend the rape. They said the people who have been arrested are not the people who did it. Now, that's no business of theirs.
So is that sophistry?
It's not sophistry. If somebody innocent, you had somebody sitting before me in the earlier program, and he is having the same problem of accusation of rape. You are coming every day. Me too movement. All kinds of accusations are going on. In the United States, a Supreme Court judge has to go, before his nomination has gone through fire for this.
Sure.
So
okay.
I am not saying that. I'm saying this is easy to make an accusation. The accusation is politically motivated. There's nobody in our leadership who has ever justified love jihad being attacked by violence. Yeah, and I think at no stage we have said we'll forcibly convert anybody.
Sure.
Muslims have forcibly converted Hindus. That there are plenty of examples. We don't believe in conversion. If you on your own want to become a Hindu, you can become a Hindu. And you don't need a pujari for that. You just say, I'm a Hindu, you become a Hindu. I'm assuming you're one, so I'm not suggesting.
So I'm routine. We people like us who are Hindus, we are routinely declared not Hindu enough and asked to go to Pakistan.
You're facing the same idiom I faced 20 years ago. So now you're getting the taste of your own medicine.
So as I said, the way that their surgery is, we'll come to that idea of ancient surgery. Maybe they should have surgical striked the revenge gene out of your body, sir. But anyway, let's come to, maybe let me just put this to you, one last question before we move away to another issue, is that would you accept that public discourse impacts people on the ground? There may be foot soldiers, people who draw strength from the discourse that people, leaders put out.
Yeah.
Do you think it is dangerous to put out discourse which might lead to violence?
Of course it is. There's a law against it. You show me that there's a direct connection between what I said and that person getting incited. Or section 295, 153. Supposing I am a person who goes to a cinema theater and the film is going on, the utter darkness, I shout, fire, fire. And everybody gets up and starts running. People get trampled, dead. Now, he has a fundamental right to say fire, fire. But he has induced this. So therefore, nobody can be excused if somebody can trace that what this man said is what we have acted on.
So we'll move away, but I'm sure you legally appreciate the point that just a little while back, 5 minutes ago, you said that it has to prove that I asked that man in Rajasthan to kill on the basis of love jihad.
No.
He accepted that the idea of love jihad made him kill this person.
Yes.
So
love jihad is going on. We know it's going on. But the answer is not using violence. You can't go outside the system. People are being prosecuted for demolishing Babri Masjid. Even though Babri Masjid was put up there by demolishing a temple. But we don't agree. That's why Advani is being prosecuted.
Okay, sir. So let's move away to what you said a little while ago, where you said that you had advised Mr. Modi that good governance is not enough. We should up the emotion quotient.
Yeah.
And you said now Hindutva has seeped enough into society for it to take root and bear 2019 fruit in 2019.
Yes.
What would you describe, sir, as being this Hindutva idea that has seeped into society?
That DNA says we are all one. So South Indians, North Indians, East Indian, West Indians, we are one people. We didn't come from somewhere, which is what the British have...
Does that include Muslims or it doesn't?
Of course. That's why I'm saying your answer. That's why I'm asking the Muslims, accept that your ancestors are Hindus. We are all part of the same family. And they would, but the mullahs don't allow them to. Privately, every Muslim tells me, I have Muslims in my family, you know that. I have Parsis in my family, Jews in my family, Christians in my family. None of them oppose this because all intelligent people who have done any reading know that the people of India from Himalayas to Kanyakumari and from Dibrugarh to Jamnagar, they all Indians are the same genetically. There's no difference.
We've been through this, so I would, for those, this genetic conversation is something that we would really urge you to go to edition one, because there's so much more on corruption, Mayawati, Akhilesh, there's so much left to talk about. Let's come to the idea of, but just to again assert that when you assert that we are all genetically the same,
yes,
it is a desire for a different kind of uniformity, not the kind of uniformity and togetherness, plurality that the constitution dictates, sir. But as I said, that's another long conversation.
You'll be defeated on that. But
Mr. Mohan Bhagwat recently gave three speeches in Vigyan Bhavan, where he enunciated Hindutva in a very new way, which is that
for
there...
For you, a new way, not for me.
Well,
he's been saying this for last 30 years to me.
Well, it's very interesting because Mr. Golwalkar used to say a different thing.
No.
Up to 2009, Mr. Sudarshan did not believe in the constitution. There was an assertion of the Hindu Rashtra. The RSS accepted that the constitution is not does not have an Indian ethos. So it was very interesting that Mr. Mohan Bhagwat said that the constitution is by consensus. He said Hindutva without Muslims would not have any meaning. Where they used to want to dominate Hindi as the strong religion, he now accepted the three language approach. And he also accepted affirmative action for castes.
Yeah.
Sir, this is a massive shift from public articulations. Maybe in private he used to tell you something else, but this is different. Would you accept?
No, I won't accept. This is what he has been saying all along.
Only to you, sir?
No. He has been saying in RSS Shakas, he has been saying, people in the journalist world have not been giving him this publicity. Now, because we are ruling party, you're giving him this publicity. I have known this from a long time, and it has been said, and I'll tell you one thing, this constitution is actually inspired by Hindutva. Why? Take, for example, ban on cow slaughter. It's there in the constitution. Take the Sanskrit. It's there, Article 351 constitution. A uniform civil code is there in the constitution. There's nothing which I would call as the pillars of Hindutva which is not in the constitution. And people like Rajendra Prasad was the president. The chairman of the Fundamental Rights Commission was Patel. And the drafting committee chairman was Ambedkar. Ambedkar's writings you have to see. He talked about the oneness of our culture. The one person who was a misfit in that whole constitutional scheme was Jawaharlal Nehru. He had no time. He was most of the time in London and meeting a special friend of his.
He spent 12... Dr. Swamy, Nehru possibly did not do anything to you, so I wonder where that revenge stems from.
It's called backward genetics.
Backward genetics. So it's unfair for, you know, anybody who's read The Discovery of India, one holds no candle for the Congress, but anybody who's read The Discovery of India would not doubt that Mr. Nehru loved this country and this civilization. Let's be fair to him intellectually.
No. I doubt that Nehru wrote that. It was ghost written.
It's ghost written?
Yeah, he never passed an exam. So how can he? Nobody in the Nehru family has passed any college exam, I'm telling you.
So it's very interesting. Now that you mentioned ghosts, just momentarily, let's move to another conversation. Yeah. We'll come back because this is a very important one. But when you speak about ghost writing, let's just stick to the word ghost. It's very interesting. The Rajasthan education minister believes that cows exhale oxygen, whereas it is proved that cows exhale methane, which is equivalent to 2,500 kgs of carbon dioxide. Sir, is it good that such a man is an education minister? Now, Mr. Satyapal Singh, who is the HRD Union Minister of State, he believes that Darwin's evolution theory should be discarded. Because he says, our Nana Nani never spoke of anybody going to the forest and seeing apes evolve into man. So this should be removed from school textbooks. He is the HRD minister, sir. You are the youngest person to get a PhD from Harvard. Are you comfortable with this kind of intellectual level amongst the company you keep?
I'm comfortable because none of these ideas will ever be implemented. So why are you worried?
Sir, they're holding very important official positions.
So what? Does anybody listen to what they're saying?
It seems so, sir.
No, there's nobody. It's none of our books which have been revised contains that monkeys descended from man, not the other way around. You see?
The only reassuring note is that Dr. Swamy has just gifted a friend of his a book that says Amongst Monkeys. Yeah. So clearly he believes in the Darwin's theory.
By the way, don't say anything ill of monkeys because that's Hanuman and I will put you a case against you.
So Mr. Vijay Rupani, who is the Chief Minister of Gujarat, he was addressing Infrastructure and Development Technology Conference. Where the director of ISRO was also there. And he said that Lord Sri Ram was the first thrower of missiles because the arrows that he was shooting were nuclear missiles. Sir, now this is the chief minister. We've already talked about the education minister and the HRD minister, sir.
That's right.
These are official positions, sir. Are you saying it is no longer important to have a level of discourse no matter what official position you hold?
Are you saying that then during the Ramayan period there were no missiles?
So I don't know because I wasn't there.
There you are.
I would certainly say there's no empirical evidence.
You are as ignorant as Mr. Rupani. That's all.
You are making an assertion
that there were no rockets during Ramayana's time. I am saying, how do you know? Did you do any research? I'm not saying that there were. I'm not even criticizing him. It's an idea. I will one day do research when I'm on a long flight from somewhere to somewhere. But I cannot condemn him for that. I'll say, okay.
No, sir, very seriously, sir, I know that you're kind of almost being facetious. I hope you are.
Listen, I will tell you, when I was a student, it was said Bhaskaracharya discovered calculus. In my class, everybody, including myself, laughed because we knew that it was Newton and Leibniz. Now, the Western world has said that it was Bhaskaracharya who first invented calculus. The whole world till about 600 years ago thought that the world is flat and the sun goes around the earth, not the other way around. Our people, Aryabhatta and all, centuries ago said that there's a planetary system. And the Puranas are based on that. Then the stars, they identified 27 stars. And they said the earth goes around the sun, not the sun that goes around. Now, we were in so far ahead at that time. Now, the other day, somebody was making fun that in Ramayana, there is a concept of Pushpak Viman. And Rama came back. And Sita was also kidnapped on an aeroplane, you see, by an aeroplane. Well, I don't know whether there was an aeroplane or not, because I haven't studied the matter. But I came across a very ancient text recently called Vimana Shastra. And in that, I said, I can't read the whole thing, because it's all in Sanskrit, it's too heavy. So I looked at for what fuel the planes were using. And it said, mercury is the fuel that was used. So I asked an aeronautical engineer, is it possible that mercury can be fuel for airlines? He said, yes, maybe another 50 years from now. Because one drop of mercury has so much energy as 10 barrels of oil. And so in the future, it could be. He didn't rule it out. So there, who thought when the time of cell phones will ever come? If he had said it 20, 30 years ago, people thought you were nuts.
So, of course, there's a big difference between taking pride in one's heritage in Ayurveda and yoga and all of that. Well, we are out of time. And as I said, we didn't even touch upon the issues of corruption. And you know, there's the Rafael deal.
Don't worry, they're all going to jail. And you can go and visit them.
Well, I'm going to look for questions. Just quickly while I'm reading this. You know, sir, you have recently a very interesting troika of people that you have raised corruption allegations against, yes, which is Anil Ambani, Mr. Adani, and Hasmukh Adia.
Yes.
Now, these are, at least some of them are involved in the Rafael deal. Some are very close to Mr. Modi, and some are very close to Mr. Jaitley. Could you quickly elaborate on these three allegations you've made, and on whom is your revenge playing out, sir?
You mean, who's going to be my first victim, is it?
Yes, Mr. Modi, Mr. Jaitley, or Mr. Adani?
No, Modi is a good friend of mine. I will never, he's a friend from a long time, from 1972. You would be surprised that during the emergency when Gujarat was under Janata government, I used to come for rest and recuperation in Gujarat. And Modi was directed by RSS, he was a Pracharak, to come to the railway station. I was also disguised as a Sardar, he was also as a Sardar. And we spent a lot of time together. So I've known him for a long time. I have nothing against Modi, except that his choice of finance minister is terrible. Okay, now, as far as these people are, Adani, I've called him a trapeze artist. Because he can take a loan from one bank and pay back the loan he took from another bank. You know, that is unheard of in any other country. And he owes, I think, 1,20,000 crores now in old loans. So he needs to be tracked. Hasmukh Adia is a scoundrel. He's the finance secretary.
So I just want to know whether we'll be legally accountable for your statements on this platform.
Nobody has won a defamation case against me. And in the course of the defamation case, they got defamed in the end. Like Mr. Jethmalani, I made him prove that he had a foreign bank account in a cross-examination. So you don't worry about that. I'll do it free for you. Now, the issue is this, that he's a scoundrel because he's targeting the very officer who is prosecuting Chidambaram. And it obviously seems to me that he wants to protect Chidambaram. And I'm not hiding it. I've written a letter to the PM giving all the details. Sometimes the PM acts on that. For example, Raghuram Rajan, all of you are all gaga about him, particularly the nice suits he wears and all that.
So Mr. Modi wears even better suits.
Well, now I will not do anything about that. But the good thing is that he wears Indian clothes wherever he's abroad. I once got into the wrong side of Jaitley because he had gone to China and he was wearing a tie coat and all that. So I said BJP ministers should not go abroad wearing Western clothes because they look like waiters in a 5-star restaurant.
So one public confession. Were you the man behind the phone call Mr. Javdekar got at the airport about why he was wearing jeans while going on?
No, that came from Modi, not from me.
Sir, I'm sorry, you said about Mr. Adani that he's a trapeze.
No, yes. Then I told you about Adya. He is targeting the very investigating officers against who are prosecuting Mr. Chidambaram. Why is he doing that? And all bogus charges. I've gone twice to the Supreme Court to get them cancelled. Then Anil Ambani is, you know, totally unlike his brother Mukesh Ambani. That's all I'll say.
In what way, sir?
Well, Mukesh is a success. That guy is a total failure.
But sir, you've made corruption charges against him in
No.
And in the Rafael deal, sir?
Rafael deal, I'm not speaking just now because Rahul Gandhi took it up. So if I take it up, he will get the credit for it. So I'll not take it up.
But sir, this is a very important point. You feel there's good grounds for Mr. Rahul Gandhi taking it up? Because you're saying if you take it up, he'll get the credit.
Rahul
so
Gandhi
the grounds are good?
Rahul Gandhi is like those people who say that Darwin's wrong and we came from monkeys. We did not come from monkeys. Monkeys came from us. I mean, I never understand what he's saying. I call him a Buddha, you know that. I'm a professor, sir. So I can recognize Buddhas very easily.
Okay, sir, Aisha Rao has a question for you. Do you think all Hindus should be asked to return to India like the Hindutva movement keeps asking Muslims to leave India?
No, we never ask Muslims to leave India. If you say that your ancestors are Hindus, how can we ask? We have no right. Their ancestors are our same as our ancestors, so there's no question of Muslims leaving India. Yeah, if somebody says Pakistan is a better place than India, then he must go. Because Pakistan was created for those Muslims who thought it is better to live in a separate country than in India. So therefore, logically, they should go. But I don't think we ever have asked Muslims to go to Pakistan. This, I think this is a hangover from Talca, I think.
So unfortunately, we have not been able to go into depth, but you know, again, in edition one, we had spoken about the fact that this 40,000 temples you spoke of was a medieval logic, political logic. And Chirantan has brought up this same issue, that the Constitution of India came into being in 1950. The temple, if it existed, possibly was demolished long before the Constitution came into being. The masjid, however, was demolished in violation of the Constitution. The temple, if it was demolished, was not in violation of the Constitution. I am a Hindu and I'm pained to see the Hindutva stand on this. Do you think Ram would have approved of setting up his temple in the manner you are going about it?
I think he needs a lecture from me on law. First of all, demolition of the masjid is not unconstitutional. It was illegal. People took law into their own hands. The Constitution gives you a fundamental right to pray, nothing more. There is nothing about protecting masjids and temples in that. What we are aggrieved is that this temple, we are not asking for in general, that's why we say we're leaving except for three, we are leaving the remaining 40,000, or remaining of the 40,000. This is a special temple where Ram was born. Now, don't tell me other countries don't do it. You go to Turkey, you will see. You go to Spain, you will see.
Sir, isn't it interesting that we always assume that Hinduism has a superior quality to it because it is so embracing, it is tolerant, it's plural.
Yes.
And yet, whenever we want to give examples for why we are doing other things, we say, but Turkey does it, Pakistan does it. You don't like what they do, but you want to emulate it.
No, not at all. I'm saying that because you people think that they're compared to us Hindus, Hindutva Walas, these people are superior people. That's why I'm giving you those examples. I am only saying one thing, that we fought the Muslims for 600 years. The Hindus did. And unlike other countries, take Persia, which is now called Iran. There were Zoroastrians. Islam conquered Persia. And in 15 years, they converted everybody to Islam. Mesopotamia, Babylon, which is called Iraq, same thing. Egypt, same thing. Europe was converted in 50 years into 100% Christian by the Christian missionaries. Whereas in our country, we had 600 years of Muslim rule and 200 years of Christian rule indirectly through the British. And yet, we are 82% Hindu because you fought everywhere.
So that is not true that one fought, because part of the Hindutva movement is an assertion that we have been sleeping for so many years, now we must assert ourselves.
No, that's not my assertion.
And unfortunately,
I think the problem is you have been speaking to enemies of Hindutva to learn about Hindutva. You come to a shaka, I will take you to there we have a separate women's shaka. You spend about 3 months there and then
but
tell
why
me.
Why separate women, sir? Is it because of an inferior intellect or why yeah. not? Why can't I sit with the men in the shaka?
Shaka is separate. But after that, we meet together. We go to public meetings together. We have discussions together. And that you have a women's separate core building in for press people in Delhi. Why? Why are you having a separate women's press club?
That's a very good point. Priyanka Thakur says, you're a PhD. Sorry, the bell is rung, but there are a lot of questions here. Maybe we'll just take one or two more. You're a PhD from Harvard, a revered economist. Shouldn't you be shaping policies rather than wasting your time on Hindu-Muslim ties?
But I should be allowed to do something on economics. Because every time I open my mouth, they think it's a criticism of the government. I can't praise the government. It's the most useless economic policies have been followed. I was against the demonetization. I was against, not because of the concept. I was against the way it was done. I was against this GST. Now the Prime Minister is doing exactly what I said it should be done. This GSTN, which is the cyber brain of GST, I said it's been given to foreign countries with banks, which are private banks, but the majority shares are held by foreigners. How can you do that? And Mr. Jaitley fought against it. When I spoke in Parliament, Congress supported Mr. Jaitley. I was all alone. Today, the Prime Minister has nationalized GSTN. And that was because of me. There are many other things I can say, but ultimately it turns out that, oh, Swami is only talking about against the government. That kind of propaganda is leashed. So therefore, I don't speak about it. I'm doing constructive work. I'm building the Ram temple. So that's construction.
That's construction. So there's a question which says, with a big political vacuum in Tamil Nadu and a need for a stable and good government, essential like never before, would it be a good idea for you to consider a CM candidate in the upcoming elections? More so, we don't see many options for BJP to make a mark in this state.
Yeah, the BJP is today in Tamil Nadu a hospitality center. It's not a political party. Whoever comes from the north, they put them in the hotels and look after them and then send them back. So there's no hope for BJP in Tamil Nadu. But we have got very good people who can be chief ministers. MGR used to say, there was a IAS officer by name Chandralekha, who's now joined us. And he was of the view that if she came to politics, he would first promote her as chief minister. And because she refused, then Jayalalitha was brought by MGR. There are a lot of good people, but our intellectuals in Tamil Nadu are frightened of this riffraff that has come from the cinema world. And they don't want to come. You go to Karnataka, you'll find middle class fully involved in politics, but not in Tamil Nadu. Tamil Nadu, it's all these cinema walas, wild chaps, and somebody is connected with the Naxalite, somebody is connected with the LTTE. It's not that kind of crowd. And
so it's a wonder no
one's... It's a violent crowd. Therefore, our people say, no, Tamils are very bright, extremely bright, but they don't have that kind of nerve to fight. So that's the problem in Tamil Nadu.
Okay, so this is the last question since you call them riffraff. Kamal Hassan says that if BJP accepts...
He's definitely riffraff.
So then there's no point putting the question to you, because the question was that if Kamal Hassan says that if BJP accepts diversity in Tamil Nadu, there's nothing wrong with working with an alliance. What is your viewpoint?
I'm dead against Kamal Hassan, this Rajinikanth, all coming to BJP. To the extent which is within my power, I'll prevent it. They are all semi-literates. They don't even know what the constitution looks like. I think their contribution to politics will be terrible. Jayalalitha was different, although I fought with her, made friends with her, fought with her, went through a cycle, finally sent her to jail. but she, after that, when it came to Supreme Court, she had died. But she was a voracious reader. She didn't want to be in politics. I have discussed with her, she was a highly intelligent person, but she had this grievance that her mother pushed her into cinema, and cinema she got brutalized. So now, therefore, we need lawyers, doctors, so on, to enter politics. But I can't give them protection once they come. That is the problem.
So unfortunately, we have to end here. Personally, one is disappointed that one couldn't pursue that conversation with you more about the RSS glasnost.
Yes.
Because
there's no glasnost.
Ram Madhav claimed that there is glasnost and that now it's time for perestroika.
Did he say that?
Yes.
I must report this to Mohan Bhagwat. There's nothing, no change. There's no amendment. He has been saying this for a long time.
So you've gone on saying that he has been saying this. Yeah. We would accept that Mohan Bhagwat has been saying
even
this.
Golwalkar.
But will you accept that it is a major shift for the RSS itself?
No, not at all. Not at all.
So unfortunately, you'll have to come back for edition
yes,
3
I'm ready to
so
come
that
back.
We can pursue that conversation.
I'm ready to come back.
Because for the moment, we will put out for the House that this is an argument that is not finished.
All
when
right.
You say that Mr. Golwalkar said the same thing,
yes.
Because even Mohan Bhagwat has accepted that yes. In bunch of thoughts, yeah. They have now taken away some of Mr. Golwalkar's thoughts and elided it.
No. He said that was dictated to some people who wrote it, and then when it was brought to his attention that these things are there, he got it removed.
This is the difference between Stuti and Smriti, I suppose.
Yeah, well, it's one form of that.
We are very, very sorry that it's such an inconclusive conversation, but we hope to have Dr. Swamy back in Bangalore for edition 3. And if you would like, then edition 4 in Chennai to pursue these conversations. Thank you very, very much, Dr. Swamy. I'd just like to share with the audience that in 1992, Dr. Swamy had written a book, An Agenda for the Renewal of India, where he said that I hope the vibrations of Mother India proved to be the unfounding of the RSS. It's very interesting today that Mr. Mohan Bhagwat is enunciating a new idea of the RSS, and Mr. Swamy seems to have gone back to an older idea of the RSS. We'll start the conversation next time with that. Thank you very, very much for being here, and we'll see you very soon again. Thank you.
No, when you quote these things, RSS is not objecting. Why are you objecting? Maybe it had been a strategy between the two of us. I was in Janata, they were in BJP.
As you said, sir, this is a continuing conversation. Thank you very, very much for being here.